United States of America looks like another silent night.
Thank you for that. Good morning. To the Church of the Living God. You feel like you're part of that? It's amazing, huh? I love that God sees us that way. Let me read out of Psalms 46 this morning. A few verses that I really enjoy. God is our refuge and our strength, a very present help in trouble. Well, we can meditate on that and camp on that verse for a long time. Then verse 8, come behold, and that's what we're doing today. Come and behold the works of the Lord. He makes wars to cease to the ends of the earth. So I was sharing the first service, we long for world peace, and one day God will make war to end. When Christ comes and establishes his kingdom upon the earth. But I'm oftentimes mindful of the war that wages within us, and Pastor Aaron's going to talk about that conflict that we have in our own hearts at times, where we want to do good, but we find ourselves doing evil. There's always seems like there's a tension, there's a strife, there's a war, and it goes on in our soul, and he is able to make that war cease. Maybe there's war in our life regarding a relationship today, something that we're battling with. Then he goes on after he talks about war, and he says, just be still. Relax. We used to say when I was young, just chill out. Be still and know that I am God. Every fear is stilled, he tells us. And every anxiety is quieted because he's God. What hope that we have in our Savior. Father, what can we say that you make wars to cease, even within our own emotions and our own mind, our will and our spirit? You remind us that we can relax, we can be still, because you've not vacated your throne. You're still the Lord of the universe. And so thank you. Every problem that we face today, you're bigger. Every mountain that we have to climb, Lord, you're able to take us beyond that. Lord, you didn't build a home in us to move away. You didn't teach us to swim that we might drown. You're with us today and forever, and we give you praise. So Lord, would you receive our thanks? May we express it through our worship, through our giving, and through an attentive ear to your word, we pray today. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand and worship God.
Let's put our hands together. Only
You may be seated. As we continue to worship, the ushers will come and gather the offering. If you're a guest here this morning, feel free to let the offering pass and just be blessed by the worship.
Oh,
Show us every day how much we really need you, Lord. How we should be seeking your face, Lord, and your righteousness. Seeking out who Jesus is in our lives, Lord. Put us in that place today, Lord, where we're desperate for you, Lord. We thank you that you're here, Lord. We thank you that you're with us. We thank you for this morning. We thank you for worship, Lord. We can sing our praises to you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Just open our hearts and our minds, Lord, as we open your word. And help us to live Christ-like lives. Doing your will and glorifying you. We thank you for this morning, Lord. We thank you for this church. And just, we thank you for Jesus. And all these things we pray in his name. Amen.
Them in on Tuesday night. And also, primetimers are coming up this Saturday. It's kind of a potluck get-together from 5 to 7. And the primetimers usually are classified as 50 or over. So, but if you're 50-ish and you want to come and join us, because we're young at heart anyways, please feel free to do. I didn't make the announcement earlier, and I was exhorted to highlight that it is a pie contest that, two types of pies, either a pumpkin or a apple, yes, pumpkin or apple, and there'll be a cook-off or whatever they're going to do there, and at the very least, there'll be a lot of pies to eat. So while we are getting ready for the message, Tony Brower is going to come up and make an announcement on the bookstore. Does anybody need, forget your Bible this morning, like to have an usher, just raise your hand and an usher will come up and give you a Bible. Okay, there's one right up here. Okay. Tony?
Good morning. My name's Tony. My wife Cindy and I oversee the bookstore ministry. And my reason here being here today is just to make you aware of some new resources that have come into the bookstore. First one we have is For the Men, A Leader After God's Own Heart by Jim George. It's a really nice book. We also got in a, if you like to journal or need something more than to write in during the sermons here, we have a sermon book. This is a purple color. Maybe the ladies would like it more than the men. I don't know, but if you're looking for just more space to write on during the service. And then for children, we have some devotionals. This is for boys. It's a VeggieTales, 365 days of devotionals for kids. And we also have one for girls in pink there. and then we also have, this one's called The Power Bible, but it's kind of a comic book type adaption of Bible stories, which is really neat, and it's geared toward kids. I guess adults could read it too, but it's a lovely resource. If you have any questions, here after the service, and all the, by the way, all the prices are on the back of the book, so if you're wondering, and that includes tax. So just, I'll be there after the service, and thank you.
Good morning again. Good morning. You just got me two books as well, Tony. What were they? The Rapture? Is that what it was called by Don Stewart? Was it just The Rapture? Fantastic book. It's a newer book, and Don Stewart's one of the scholars, one of the theologians kind of in Calvary Chapel. And so what he did is he wrote a book that explains the six or seven different views on the rapture, and then shares, you know, what he believes and what we agree with is the what the Bible teaches in regard to the rapture, and that is, of course, that it could occur at any moment. Amen. What was the other book, the archaeology in the Bible? Do you remember? It's like the Bible handbook of. But anyway, it's a fantastic book, and it's a newer book, but it traces all the most current, up to the most current archaeological finds and discoveries, and how that relates to Bible history. And so it's essential, good ways for you to be built up in your faith. Take advantage of the bookstore. Amen? Where are they? Why don't you guys stand up, Stephen Marina? It's a surprise! Stephen Marina, Kamek. Our missionaries in Southeast Asia are back for a week for a quick visit. And so make sure you say hi to them before you leave today. We're thrilled with them, so proud of them. Great to partner with them. Great story. If you haven't heard it, ask somebody after the service. We love these things. And so praise God they're here this morning. Well, today let's open our Bibles, 1 John chapter 2. As we continue our course through the New Testament, we pick up where we left off last week, verse 15. And we'll take a look at verses 15 through 17 this morning, as that seems to be a section right there. A sub-context within this context, if you will. And the title for our message today is on the screen, A Dangerous Affair, A Dangerous Affair. Let's go to the Lord. Father, we're so thankful today that you're here and that you love us as much as you do. Lord, thank you for the mystery of your love. Thank you that your love is unexplainable. Why God so loves the world, we just don't know. Lord, we know we're not worthy of perfect divine love. And yet, Lord, you lavish it on us and you want to lavish that love on us. It's not cheap, but it's free. We thank you, Lord, as we always want to celebrate that it's through the finished work of Jesus Christ that we can come and find fellowship with our Father God, our Creator. We can walk with you every day of our lives and just extend that relationship for all eternity. And it always comes back to, Lord, the person of Jesus Christ. He's the one that we give ourselves to completely in light of the gift of Himself that He's given us. And so, Lord, we're so privileged to come and just enjoy your love today. Lord, thank you that part of your love is speaking truth into our lives. And so, speak truth into our lives today. Thank you, Lord, that whenever you do, your desire is to set us free, never to bum us out or burden us down, but to set us free, Lord, from what binds us and holds us. And so speak your love today. This is a tough text, Lord, but speak your love today by speaking truth that we might be set free. We thank you, Lord God. We give you our attention now. Lord, we quiet our hearts and minds. We're asking to hear the voice of the Holy Spirit. We're asking you to work your word out in us. Make it understandable, God, and make it so very applicable, so we can do, Lord, according to what you say here. Bless your word. Bless your people, God. Thank you so much that they're here today. There are those watching and streaming online right now. Lord, those listening after the fact right now, we just are so thankful to be serving you and serving your people. We're thankful for good fruit continuously in this ministry. God, just keep it coming, we pray. Keep us in the place where you can continue to use us, Lord. And do use us. Thank you for this family. Thank you for this fellowship. In Jesus' name, let's say together, amen. Amen. One author wrote this. It's on the screen, and I think it's a great introduction for our text today. He said, though we do not face a pantheon of false gods like the Israelites did, we face pressures from a pantheon of false values, don't we? Think this through. materialism, love of leisure, sensuality, worship of self, security, and many others. The second commandment, he says, deals with idols. That, of course, is Exodus 20, verse 3. Thou shalt have what? No other gods before me. We know that. But he says, and I think it's really important for us to consider, this may be something that most of us can't relate to unless we include life goals that revolve around something other than God Himself. What is the object of our affections, our efforts, and our attention? Where does the majority of our time go? On what do we spend the greatest amount of our resources? I love that clarified thought, because in so many ways that's the question that John now calls us to consider as we transition into verse 15 through 17. On what do we spend the greatest amount of our resources? Where does the majority of our time go? What are the objects of our affection, attention? I like verses 12 through 14 that we covered last Sunday. John pushes the pause button on all this exhortation to simply encourage and appreciate his people. And that's important. And I pray we enjoyed our time together last week as we just appreciated where each one of us are at in our walk with the Lord. Different stages of growth, different levels of maturity. I love that John paused to praise and encourage his people. But verse 15, we're right back at it. John is continuing to address the subject of fellowship with God. And here in verse 15, he goes on to talk about what will always wage war against our fellowship with the Father, and that is the subject of spiritual adultery. And if you want to write that down, please do so. The subject of spiritual adultery, verses 15 through 17. Let's read together now. John says, "Do not love the world or the things in the world." You can feel free and read it out loud with us. "If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world is passing away in the lust of it, but he who does the will of God abides forever." I want to read this passage again in the New Living Translation. It is such a great rendition that helps us understand what's being said. It's on the screen. Again, "Do not love this world," John says, "nor the things it offers you. For when you love the world, you do not have the love of the Father in you. For the world offers only a craving for physical pleasure, a craving for everything we see, and pride in our achievements and possessions. These are not from the Father, but are from this world. And this world is fading away, along with everything that people crave. But anyone who does what pleases God will live forever." John, no doubt, is issuing a new covenant Christian commandment here. And we said in the first service, you can say it in King James if you want, "Do not love the world or the things in the world," or "Thou shalt not love the world or the things in the world." This is a new covenant, New Testament Christian commandment. Certainly. But I think additionally, John is simply making a spiritual declaration here, and he's affixing a warning to it. He's saying, this is that, and here's what will come if you do. He simply says, do not love the world or the things in the world. Because if anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. You can't have it both ways. Amen? What an important word this is for our culture today. We said to the first service, our Christian ease culture, E-A-S-E, ease, the easy form of Christianity that we seem to see all around us, which seems to be possibly at times a different version of the faith than we read about here in the Bible. Amen? This is black and white. This is very straightforward. This is a sober word, and thus we should take the subject seriously. It's an important word for us to understand in these last days. Do not love the world, he says, or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Now, so we can understand exactly what John is talking about here, take a few notes if you would. Understand firstly that John is not speaking of the earth itself globally. He's not talking about the world as in our planet, planet earth. Don't love the world. Don't love planet earth, as it were. Psalm 24 verse 1 says this, "The earth is the Lord's in all its fullness, the world and those who dwell therein." I think it's okay to love the earth. I think God loves the earth. If you're one of those folks, you're like from Portland or Oregon or the Northwest, and you're really into trees and grass and saving the whales and the chipmunks and making sure the walrus eat and all those kinds of things, I think that's great. I think we might say God loves the earth. He made the earth. He owns the earth. He loves the earth. To a certain extent, we should love the earth as well. Should enjoy the earth and take good care of it, be good stewards of it. John is not saying hate planet earth or hate the globe, don't love the world in that sense, is he? Nor is John, secondly, let's understand this, John is not speaking of the mass of humanity, the world as in the people that live on this planet, in this place. He's not talking about that either. We know this because John 3:16, I pray it's one of our favorite verses, "For God so loved," what? "The world, that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." John is not saying don't love the world, as in the people who occupy this planet, because God loves the people that He's created, every single one who occupy this planet. If you love the lost, if you love the world, then you're in good company. You're like God, and that's a good thing. Amen? The thought that John is expressing here is spoken of elsewhere in the Scripture by Jesus, by James, by Peter, by Paul, as we'll see shortly. When you read this expression, the world, think of it in this way, and you might write this down, as an entity hostile to God, an entity hostile to God. That's what we mean when we describe, when we say, the world. Someone said this, and it's on the screen. It is, that is the world, it is the community of sinful humanity that is united in rebellion against God. A community of rebels, he says here, and that's important. Characterized by sin, that's how you'll know them, and they're in fact led by Satan himself. Three times in John's gospel, I'm sure it left an imprint on his heart and his mind. It's what's inspiring him to teach the way that he is here, directly. Three times in John's gospel, Jesus calls the devil the ruler of this world, the leader, as it were, of this rebellion. Now, it's important that we understand that Satan does not have ultimate authority over this world or the people in it, does he? But listen, he is the leader of the rebellion against God within this world. There's only one. Listen, he's the leader of the rebellion against God within the world. Thus, we have the world. Don't love the world or the things in the world, of the world, because they're not of God at all. Someone said this, "We are not to love either the world system or its way of doing things. There is a secular anti-God or ignoring God way of doing things that characterizes human society, and it is easy to love, as we'll see in a moment, the world in this sense." We Christians need to learn to recognize that there is a will that is contrary to the will of God at work in the world. It is opposite of the will of God. It's contrary to the wisdom of His Word. There is a kingdom of darkness on this planet that is led by Satan himself and that's characterized by sin, as we'll see shortly. And thus we know as Christians, we should know that every person who lives has then a choice to make. And not choosing is a choice. Every person will either follow the kingdom of heaven or they will fall into the kingdom of hell. There's no neutrality. There's no middle ground. There's no living for the Lord and living like the world kind of position that we can seek, create, or find. It's following God, the Lord Jesus Christ, or those in rebellion against Him led by the devil. It's one or the other. When that understanding is comprehended by our minds and hopefully in our hearts, we understand what John is saying here. That's exactly why you can't love the world, as it were, and love God. It's a treasonous choice. It's at its very heart antichrist. James said it this way, James 4:4, and this is in the New Living Translation. Don't you realize that friendship with the world makes you an enemy of God? I say it again, if you want to be a friend of the world, you make yourself an enemy of God. How can we love what God hates? God hates sin, and we'll touch on that in a moment. It's wicked and evil and destructive. How can we love or make light of what He hates, befriend sin or Satan, and call ourselves Christians, or say we love God? It's impossible. You can't have it both ways. Though often I want that to be true or wish it were. It does not work that way. Amen? Do not love, John says so simply here. Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. What does that look like practically? John tells us here. Exactly defining on what loving the world looks like. What is it to be worldly? Sometimes we wonder. This is an extremely serious statement, and we should consider exactly what it means. John tells us in verse 16, I think, and he says, for all that is in the world, all of it, that's all that's here, by the way, that's all that's in the camp of Satan, that's all that's in the kingdom of darkness, it's sin, as we'll see in a moment. It's all that's there. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world is passing away in the lust of it, but he who does the will of God abides forever. The world is described or characterized here by the things in the world, the things of the world. And these, of course, as John says right here, these are things that are contrary to God. They are actions, they are activities that are the opposite of all that God is and all that God stands for. God is light, and in Him dwells no darkness at all. And so what's being described here, what is it to be worldly? What is it to love the world? Well, the activities that go on in this place among those who are worldly are sinful things. They're self-centered activities. They're pursuits. They are practices that are summed up in this way. Sinful, carnal, fleshly. And they're idolatrous by their very nature. If you want to write it down, we might simplify what John is saying here in this very short sentence. To love the world is to live for sin. To love the world is to live for sin. And John gives us three different classifications of sin here, and I believe that every sin can be seen in one of these categories, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. To love the world is to live for sin, to live for the lust of the flesh. And that is fulfilling our body's sexual appetites, engaging in fornication and adultery and thinking nothing of it, but living to fulfill those lusts of the flesh, sinful things. That is what it is to love the world. To love the world is to live for, he says secondly here, the lust of the eyes, and that is longing, craving certain things or experiences to get, to gain, to obtain material possessions, to have increased finances. It's really the love of money, which is a root of all kinds of evil. Oftentimes, those who get rich off of someone else. And that is what this sin is described as. Doing whatever it takes, whatever's necessary to get what I want. The lust of the eyes, whatever I look upon, that's what I'm going to have. House or boat or car or plane or whatever it is, that's what I live for. to have the biggest bank account, to amass the most toys, as it were. To love the world is to live for money, gain, possessions. And thirdly, John describes for us here, he says to love the world, as it were, is to, you know, live for the pride of life. That paints a picture of power and pursuing prestige, prominence, to have authority over others. I crave, I long for the ability to tell others what to do, and they have to because I'm in that position of authority. I'm the man. I'm the final word. And that is by its very nature a sinful desire because it's pride. I will and I will and I will, Satan said. In his desire to not be bigger or better than God, because that's impossible, but to simply be like the Almighty. It's a sin and it's pride and it's wrong. Absolute power corrupts absolutely. Even a little bit of power goes to our head, doesn't it? And thus it's sin. To love the world, John kind of says here, is to live for lust, amass possessions and being corrupted by them, pursuing prominence and position. It's pride. All sin can be summed up in these three things, I think. And thus, to love the world is to live for sin of one kind or another. Everything falls into one of these categories, and it's what loving the world is and what it leads to. Craving after. I like that New Living Translation, that rendition. To crave sexual gratification sinfully through fornication or adultery, pornography. To crave, you know, houses, boats, cars over and in place of anything else. To crave that position of prominence or power because you want others to be enamored by your excellence. We hear that word a lot in our time today, don't we? We don't hear the word to lust much, but we hear the word crave, don't we? Joked with the first service a little bit about examples of our craving. And I won't do that second service because it's approaching lunchtime and that would be too distracting. But often the world says something like this to us, doesn't it? Well, it's not lust per se, but it's just a craving. That's the word we use. It's just a craving for this, or it's a craving for that, or it's a craving for the other. And isn't that kind of a good thing? Isn't that a pleasing thing to satisfy a craving that you have, even if it's kind of sinful? Satisfying a craving certainly can be fulfilling, but sin never delivers satisfaction, does it? It feels good for a second or two, but a few moments later, death is at the door. Despair follows. Destruction is coming. Sin always promises to provide so much, to deliver fulfillment. And if only we give in to those cravings, the world says, things will work out well, we'll be content. But sin, by its very nature, can only deliver destruction. It's what it is. And it's why God has set himself against it. It can only bring pain and problems and sickness and death. It's interesting that sin only creates a dissatisfaction within us, making the rest of the world unable to please or fulfill us. Sin creates in us, it promises to fulfill a craving, but all it ends up doing, have you been there? Is increasing our dissatisfaction with the good things that are around us, and it leads us deeper and deeper into that particular kind of sin, doesn't it? God has set himself against sin. He's made himself an enemy of sin, of the way of the world, which is sinful, led by Satan. You're aware of this, right? God has set himself against. He's drawn the battle line against sin. And its leader, if you will, Satan. And thus to love the world, thus to love sin, think light of it, listen. It's the ultimate expression of rebellion against God. Sin is siding with Satan. And we've got to get that. I need to understand this. Someone said, the reason love for the world is incompatible with love for God is that everything in the world comes not from the Father, but from the world. The world thus conceived is a system of values and goals from which God is excluded. Someone else said, the world competes for the love of Christians. I like that one. The world competes for the love of Christians, and one cannot both love it and the Father at the same time. What does the world want from us? John says it here. What does it want? Our love. What does that look like? Think into your own personal lives for a moment. Let the Holy Spirit speak to you. How is love expressed? Love is expressed in time. Love is expressed in attention. Love is expressed in expense. And thus, the world encourages us. It's a magnetic force that pulls us. We're persuaded by it. To give it our time, our attention, and our money to the world instead of to the Lord and the things of God. The world buys our love, doesn't it? Our time, our attention, and our finances. And it rewards its lovers with, you know, technology and cars and little iPhones and gadgets and all these little trinkets that then take us deeper, oftentimes, into worldliness. Our hearts become more at home in the world when we give ourselves to the things of the world. At best, as John says here, the world does reward us for the time, the attention, the finances that we give it. But at best, those rewards are temporary and they are fleeting. And the problem is that when we gain and seek what the world has to offer, we lose the honor, the comfort, the joy, the reward of heaven. It's one or the other. Amen? One author said this, and it's very appropriate. I like it a lot. He said, what other gods could we have besides the Lord? Plenty. For Israel, there were the Canaanite Baals, those jolly nature gods whose worship was a rampage of gluttony, drunkenness, and ritual prostitution. For us, it looks a little different today, doesn't it? For us, there are still the great gods, sex, shekels, and stomach. An unholy trinity constituting one God's self, me. And the other enslaving trio, pleasure, possessions, and position, whose worship is described as, we just read it, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. He says football, the firm, and family are also gods for some. Indeed, the list of other gods is endless. For anything that anyone allows to run his life becomes his God. And the claimants for this prerogative are legion. That is, there are so many to choose from. In the matter of life's basic loyalty, temptation is a many-headed monster. Amen? I think we all recognize this. I think we all understand that. At least I pray we do. What do we do about it? Amen? What do we do with John's warning here? It's a spiritual declaration. It's a divine truth. You cannot love God in the world. It's impossible. Something's wrong. It's not right. So what do we do with that sobering warning? How do we deal with the pull on our hearts and our minds for our attention, for our finances? And we love it for a moment or two until we become enslaved by it. It's a magnetic pull on our attention, on our affection. How do we deal with that as Christians? As we said to the first service, do we monk out? Do we go to a nunnery? Do we do as some have done in church history? And that is, man, we run away. I'm going to run away from the world. I'm going to go into seclusion. I'm going to close myself in a closet. And worldliness can't get me there. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life. I'm going to hide in a closet, so I won't see the commercials anymore. The advertisements, the jingles that just haunt me and plague me. I see what everyone else wears and has, and I just, I look at men and I look at women and I'm lusting. And so here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go to a monastery. I'm going to become a monk or join the nunnery. And people have tried that, and you can read their own testimony. It doesn't work, does it? I'm going to go where sin can't distract me. The problem with that kind of thinking is wherever you go, you're going to bring the world with you because you're worldly. Because I have a flesh that follows me. Have you ever tried to run away from the flesh? I mean, good luck with that. It's like Jonah trying to run away from Jesus, right? I'm going to get on a boat and I'm going to sail like so far that God won't be there. I mean, it's the same kind of thinking. If you're going to run away or get away from your flesh is going to follow you like a monkey on our back, like a dead body on our shoulder. Wherever you go, the flesh there is going to be, which is why we long for heaven when we're finally freed from this physical body that seeks to sucker us into sin. Additionally, it won't work, but additionally, Jesus called us to do the opposite, didn't he? John 17:4, Jesus instructed us, he prayed for us that we would be in the world but not of the world. In the world, that we'd live surrounded by the lost, the world, but that we would live nothing like the way the world lives. Amen? So how do we win the war against worldliness? I think firstly, we need to accept what Jesus declared in Matthew 6:24. And this is a tough one. You know, in my flesh, I want to deny the truth that Jesus shares here. But it's divine truth spoken in love. And I've got to come to terms with this if I'm going to walk and do well, if I'm going to win the war against worldliness. Jesus said, Matthew 6:24, and no doubt John is writing what he is here in 1 John 2, based on what Jesus said there. Jesus said it again in Luke's Gospel. Matthew 6:24, New Living Translation, Jesus said, no one can serve two masters. That's what John's saying here. For you will hate one and love the other. That's just how it's going to be. You will be devoted to one and despise the other. It's just like a husband and a wife. Oh, I can do this outside of my marriage over there and still love my wife here. We covered this recently on a Wednesday night. That's impossible. It's absurd. I'm going to give 100% of my love to my spouse here, and yet I have a little pornography or a little emotional affair or a little online chatting over here. It's called adultery. That's not what marriage is. That's not how it works. You can't do both. You're violating one for the other, breaking the covenant of one for the other. And yet we kind of think that's possible. It's not. The same thing is true of worldliness, worldly ways, worldly living, and Christianity. You can't have both. Pick whichever one you want. You're free to do that. And we'll love you the same. We'll pray a lot for you. May have some consequences or disciplines that come your way, but make your choice. You can't have both. No one can serve two masters. You can't work for Apple and Hewlett-Packard. It's not going to work. One will fire you. You'd be like a spy in the enemy's camp. That's just not going to happen. Did that work? Was that good? You were quiet. Thought it was pretty good. Hewlett-Packard's still in business, right? No one can serve two masters. Here's the thing. You'll hate one and love the other. You'll be devoted to one and despise the other. Jesus says it like this. You cannot serve both God and mammon or money. Worldliness is what it means, worldly living. I need to get this. I need to accept this once and for all. And when I forget it, I need to come back to it. I cannot live for the Lord and live like the world. That's impossible. That's not going to work. I'm only going to find myself frustrated. I'm going to live a life of waste and loss. So firstly, I think we need to accept what Jesus says here. Secondly, I think we should look to the example of Lot in Genesis chapter 13. Now, That's your homework for this morning. It's where we're going to have a short study so you can go home, take someone out to lunch, and discuss Genesis 13. The example of Lot. Most of you are probably familiar with the passage. If not, read all about it. The Bible calls Lot a righteous man. The Bible says that Lot was a godly guy, the nephew of Abraham. But he wasted his life and he made a foolish choice that cost him everything. And there are those that are Christians today who go the same way and it works out just the same as it did for Lot. He proverbially pitched his tent towards Sodom. He chose to live near the place that's synonymous with, you know, all kinds of sin. And lost his wife, lost his kids, and created all kinds of difficulty for the people of God through his foolish choice. I like how one commentator summed up Lot's story. It's on the screen. Read with me. He says, Lot was selfish and chose for himself what seemed the most lucrative without considering the spiritual implications of what he was doing. He had worldly status, influence, wealth, and comfort. Yet it was all taken away in a moment when the judgment of God came upon Sodom and Gomorrah. I like this last line. Lot put all his eggs in the wrong basket and was burned by the fact that the world is passing away. Lost so much because of a foolish choice. And God has better than that for us. Thirdly and finally, I think that the answer I'm blessed by, I'll say, the fact that, in most cases, the answers to our questions come from the text that we're studying. And I think John answers this question in verse 17. He says, and the world is passing away. Don't invest in it, you'll lose it. The world is passing away in the lust of it, but he who what? Does the will of God. Ding, ding, ding. He who does the will of God abides forever. In our fight against the flesh, if our prayer is to avoid the passing pleasures of this world that promise a lot and don't deliver much, listen, the answer is right there. You'll find your life in losing it for the Lord. You'll find your life in service to the Lord. You give your eyes that long and your flesh that lusts and your pride that desires prominence, and you put on the apron as Jesus donned it and washed the feet of his disciples. Jesus said, my food is to do the will of him who sent me. Jesus said as a young boy, I must be about my Father's business. Jesus was consumed with his service to the Lord and things worked out pretty well. John says, he who does the will of God abides or lasts or lives forever. And I will say this, as much as you make that your priority, doing whatever God is directing you to do in his word, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. The more that you're sitting in this service today and in your devotions every morning, you're praying, God, I'm here to do what you want me to with my finances, with my physicality, my mental ability. I'm yours. I desire to serve in your house forever. And so, Lord, use me. To the extent that you make your service to the Lord a priority in your life, you will do well and be blessed. You will find yourself struggling with your flesh and just with worldliness as a whole, a whole lot less. So the key, as always, comes, I think, from our text, and it seems so simply. Give yourself to the service of the Lord. I'll read this and we'll close. Romans 12, verse 1 in the New Living Translation. Paul sums it up. Great word for us today. He says, and so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he's done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him. Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. I love that passage. It's a prime Christian verse in truth. Why? Because it holds the answer to this question, doesn't it? Well, how do I know what the will of God is? How am I going to know what God wants me to do? Present yourself to Him right now and He'll tell you. Lord, I am here for You. You've redeemed me. You've dedicated me. You've called me to live like Christ. And so tell me how to serve, what to do, where to go, how to give, whatever the case may be. Instruct me in how I might live for You, that I can abide in Your house forever. Devote yourself, dedicate yourself, give yourself, as He says here, present yourself to the Lord. Here I am, God. What do You want to do? Father, that's our desire as we close today. None of us profess much. Lord, at least hopefully we don't. None of us profess great spirituality or complete success in these things. We're all, Lord, in need of a work of Your Holy Spirit. We thank You that there are examples in life we can look to of those who are applying these things. Lord, there's a couple in our church right now who sold everything they own and moved away as missionaries. And that's a good example. That's someone to look to and listen to and learn from. They've done it. They're doing it, Lord. None of us profess to be anything great, Lord, but we do see the success that such a sacrifice brings. It's present day, real life joy as we serve You completely, God. Not being dragged down and weighed down and caught up in the trippings of the world, God. Cure our culture, the church, from Black Friday, God. This infectious, Lord, desire to get and gain and have. And Lord, it's crazy. It's crazy. As we present ourselves to You alive from the dead, we do that right now. Do a work in us, we pray. As we say, Lord, here are my eyes, here's my mind, here's my hands, here's my heart. Lord, I want to give myself to Your service. Speak to me, direct me, tell me how to give, where to go, what to do. Help us to do this every day, Father. The world has such a pull on us. Our flesh, God, it's a fight, and we confess that. But greater are You than he who is in the world. Greater are You than the flesh that we fight against. The victory comes through Jesus Christ our Lord. So God, we present ourselves. Direct us, lead us, speak to us. What needs to go in our lives? What needs to stop? What do we need to quit? What's captivating our attention? What's distracting us from our service? Speak to us, Lord. Thank You that none of us are qualified in this room to tell each other what to do. Get rid of this or sell that. Lord, but we will listen to You. And You will speak to us, Lord. And You'll free us, God, ever increasingly from the grip of the world, what chokes out our life, the cares of this world. Show us, Lord, as we listen to the direction of Your Spirit, God, how joy-filled this life can be as we live for You and for Your glory. Lord, send us out in joy this morning. Send us out, God, excited, anticipating what You're going to do and what You're going to say as we seek You. Raise us up, Lord. A generation of those who seek Your face, God, called after Your name, Lord, just longing to give to You the way You've given to us. Thank You for this verse. Thank You for this passage. Lord, be glorified as we apply it. In Jesus' name, let's say together, amen. Amen. And we say, amen. Amen. Always such a privilege to be together in worship and in study. I pray your week is so very blessed and filled with ministry. I pray the Lord presents you an opportunity to preach the gospel to someone this week and you take it. Amen. If you'd like any prayer, come on up. The elders and some pastors will be up front. Enjoy your week. Join us on Wednesday night for Deuteronomy 25. God bless.